This is John Stewart, Green Lantern of Sector 2814, and you are listening to Geek Talk.
This is Professor Charles Xavier. There are more powerful mutants out there, but they're listening to Geek Talk.
What's up, everybody? It's Brad Hawkins, Ryan Steele from VR Troopers. We are VR, and you're tuned in to Geek Talk.
This is Dr. Egghead. How am I supposed to conquer the world and build the Eggman Empire if they're always listening to Geek Talk? Hedgehog!
This is the Didact. Humanity's imprisonment is a kindness, but not while listening to Geek Talk.
This is Ryu from Wreck-It Ralph, and you're listening to Geek Talk.
Hadouken!
This is Marek Ishtar. Let the Shadow Game begin! You're listening to Geek Talk.
This is Juno Eclipse. I've got a bad feeling about this, but you're listening to Geek Talk.
This is Commodore Don Krieg of One Piece. Don't ever defy me. Listen to Geek Talk. That is an order.
Hey, this is Greg Weissman. I was the creator and one of the producers of Gargoyles, and you're listening to Geek Talk.
Hey, it's James Arnold Taylor, the voice of Obi-Wan Kenobi.
And Master Plo Koon. And I sense the Force is strong with Geek Talk.
Master Plo? Do you talk geek?
Koto ya, Obi-Wan. Koto ya.
Oh, Koto ya indeed. Now, if anybody else can figure out what he's talking about, let's listen to Geek Talk.
And today I have with me, all the way from Toronto, Canada, John Stocker. He was the voice of Vlix in Star Wars Droids.
That's right.
Welcome there, John.
Thank you very much, Tony. Nice to be with you. I appreciate it.
Yeah, it's kind of nice to have somebody who's been in, has had such a historic career in voiceover.
Thank you. Yeah, it's been a long haul.
Yeah,
it's a long haul, but a good one, a good haul, you know.
What's been the most fun about doing it?
Well, you know, I got to be honest. I don't want to sound like a guy saying, well, back in the day, why we used to, but, you know, the old days really were probably more fun in terms of performing than they are now, only because we were given a little bit more creativity. The talent pool was considerably smaller, and there was a great deal of trust. Producers had a great deal of trust in the performer. So often I would be called in and just told, okay, you're going to be doing this today. No audition, no nothing. They would just call me and say, you know, we had sort of, before you rolled on this, we talked about a couple of shows at Star Wars, and rather, Droids and Ewoks, which were the Star Wars spinoffs. And on those shows, pardon me, when the director, the voice director called me in, he would just show me a picture and what do you got for this guy?
So he basically, you didn't even have a script to work with.
Well, I had a script, but I didn't. But we always have scripts when we do animation. But in terms of the freedom of developing a voice now, because I'm involved sort of on the other end a great deal too, because I'm a voice director and I'm a casting director. Every performer is given parameters. They've got to sound like this. We want this. We want that. You know, you've got the psychologists and the educators and the and everybody else involved in the scripting, so they're involved also in the vocalization. They don't want it to be too much this way, they don't want it to be too much that way. Don't want to scare the kids, you don't want to traumatize kids. It's gotten very politically correct. And
right.
We know what political correctness does everywhere. It's the same in my business. It takes away some of the creativity because you're locked into having to deliver a certain way. It goes beyond simply entertaining. It becomes, we don't want to say that because somebody will be offended, or we don't want to use this phrase, or we don't want to have that kind of accent because someone's going to be offended. In those days, it was very, very different. We didn't have to worry about it. Consequently, so many of those old shows are still popular today. They're either being rerun on retro, a lot of the retro animation channels, or there's still groups like you guys who are still interested in them.
Well, of course.
Because we weren't told exactly what we had to do, and we had some freedoms, and we weren't working inside a box, the quality was very, very different, and they became timeless.
Right. And one of the many voices that you actually did is basically based off a video game. I still watch a little bit of this on DVD or Netflix sometimes, is you were on Super Mario Brothers as Toad.
That's right. Well, actually, in fact, Tony, you've got it backwards, because the series was first. The animated series, the Super Mario Brothers series,
right,
was before the video games.
Oh, it was?
Yes, it was. And it was because the three seasons that we did were all done in Toronto. And then they came up with a very, very, as you recall, early video games are very simplistic. And I did the first one. Nobody even knows about it. I don't even know if it ever got produced for sale. But that's when it was after that the video games began being produced with a different Toad, a different voice of Toad, and different characters, different voice actors for the characters. And I had nothing to do with it after the animated series was completed.
Oh, okay. But, so you never even
played
the...
Yeah, but it was originally done, the first voices were the ones done in Toronto.
Okay, so you guys never actually even... You haven't ever played the actual video games.
No, I was not in the video games.
Well, that's...
But I was... That's interesting, eh? Yeah, I was the... But I was the original Toad.
Yeah, that was actually pretty cool. When I heard that voice, I'm like, okay.
Yeah.
Okay. And then I
haven't gone to sort of specifically Super Mario Brothers conventions, but when I do a lot of the cons through Canada and the States, Toad is always one of the real big hits for people, and I do get a lot of response to that particular character. A lot of signings on my Toad stuff.
And do you ever get anybody saying, do the voice, do the voice?
If I told you how often I come out of their horse, I'm doing it. Because they asked for, everybody wants, and that's great. I mean, that's part of the thing. You know, you create something, you get paid for it, it's yours. I feel you're kind of obligated as a performer to give back.
Right.
I don't want to sound too corny, but when you do something and you develop a fandom, that's what you owe them for their loyalty and their love and everything else. So when somebody says to me, can you do a particular voice, and that's part of my gig, and I've got to give them what they want. It's either that or Beastly or one of the other whatever character they want me to do.
Yeah. And out of all your characters, I'd say, what has been the most fun for you to do?
I got to go back to the early 80s and say Beastly.
Okay.
From Care Bears. Yeah. He's the one that's the most popular of all my characters. And he's the one that, Beastly's into kind of third generation now of fans. I get, at cons, I'll get moms come up to me with their kids, and the moms are like half my age, and they're saying, "Oh my God, I watched Care Bears when I was little, and now my daughter watches it, and it's really wonderful." And Beastly was pretty special. He kind of kicked off my career in many ways, and I kind of owe that little fella a big thank you for getting me rolling.
Yeah, a lot of people probably don't. I'm a little bit old school here, and I remember a little bit of this cartoon is The Adventures of Teddy Ruxpin.
Oh, my. I just got contacted by the people who have the biggest Teddy Ruxpin fan site. And I've got, honestly, I've got right in front of me on my screen, I've got a little icon saying, fill in Teddy Ruxpin interview. So I just got contacted by a guy. It's
That's not me.
No, I know. His name is Josh something or other. Josh Isaacson or something. And he, I don't know where the heck he's from. But it's somewhere in the States as well. And, yeah, there it is. I got a big Q&A in front of me. Interestingly enough, the voice director from that show, Chuck Rubin, now lives, I told you before we started the interview, that I was heading off to Mexico for January and February. And a large part of the reason is to visit my friend Chuck, who was the voice director of Teddy Ruxpin. And he, because he and his wife live in this little town in Mexico.
Nice.
So, it's going to be, I haven't seen him in about 3 years. And I still love, I have such beautiful memories of doing Newton Gimmick in Teddy Ruxpin. It was an interesting series, insofar as most series, every episode is kind of a self-supporting, self-sufficient entity. Teddy Ruxpin
right.
was 65 continuous episodes. If you missed one, you missed something in the story. And it went from all through, from episode 1 right through to 65. It was one long tale, although there was a different adventure in each one. It was one long story of Teddy finding his long-lost dad.
Right.
And it was lovely because there are very few animated shows that have that. As I say, most of them are just you've got a situation, you've got characters, and it's a chunk out of their life. They're not necessarily following on a timeline.
Right. And you also were part of X-Men, one of my favorite
yes.
TV series.
Yeah.
Played two
United
different characters.
Big Band. From United They Stand, there have been three Ultrons, and I was one of them. I was I think we did that in early 2001, and we only did 13 episodes of that. I remember it was fun though, because it was a voice that I had never used. I created the voice of Ultron when I came in and auditioned. It was like that. It was one of those really weird voices, and I remember when I did it, the guys just jumped out of their seats and said, "That's it, that's the voice. Okay, let's go, let's do it."
Yeah, see, I myself do a little bit of a voice of Yoda myself when it comes down to it.
Yeah, you can't do Yoda. Yeah, you got to be careful when you do other voices, because we live in a litigious society. Somebody will sue you. I mean, even the Simpsons have dope. Copyrighted, so you know, you gotta
You're
be careful.
Right. I don't do it professionally. I just do it just for fun. And
right.
I've had Dave Fennoy tell me it was really good. Everybody so far told me it was close to Frank Oz. So.
Oh wow! Well, listen, man. Maybe you have another
yes.
career. If the podcast fails,
you
know, yeah, that is good.
So, but yeah, and then you also have been in. I've actually been a while since I've watched it, but you actually were part of the kids' show, Babar.
Babar, yes. Babar, I was in the original, the first couple of years that Babar was done. And again, it was done by Nelvana. Care Bears was a Nelvana production, and so was, we talked about the Droids and Ewoks, that was Nelvana. That was an animation company based in Toronto, and Babar is, I did the first 2 years, or three, I remember it was either two or three, as I was Rataxus's sidekick, Basil, in that a really high-pitched voice, sort of in the Toad range, but not quite.
Right.
You know, if you asked me to do it today, I'd probably hurt myself.
I won't ask you to do it.
That was good. He was a similar kind of character to Beastly. I always say the best animated characters, the best ones are the bad guy's sidekick in a cartoon. Because
right.
the bad guy's sidekick always really, really wants to be good. Right? They're being bad because there's a paycheck.
Right.
But they really have a good heart. I love that. I sort of love that position, that character position.
Yeah, so basically, out of... When you do go into, like, say, these voiceovers, has, what do you use, like, for a process? I mean, like, say, getting ready, or...
You know what? Though, you know, I do a lot of teaching, and I have, you know, a lot of students, and I tell them they should sort of loosen their voice up and, you know, do whatever loosens your voice up. You know, it's a hot cup of tea or gargling or a hot shower in the morning. And I feel kind of dishonest because I do nothing. I've never done anything. I've never done warm-ups.
Right.
I've never done sort of the traditional, you know, vocal stretches, if you will. I've never done any of that stuff. I just walk in and do it. And again, though I teach that you should, I guess, you know, because I know for most people it's necessary. I guess I've been blessed, or I'm just very, very fortunate that, you know, I've never had to do it. I just do what I do.
Right. And for the process of teaching, I mean, when did you start getting into that?
Teaching was a few years ago. I had, I was kind of prodded into it because I was doing some work for a teaching sort of company, if you will, I didn't agree totally with their methods, but they knew I was qualified, and my versatility in terms of being able to teach an animation class or to teach a commercial voiceover class, I was kind of a floater, and I would do any of those things. They just approached me simply because of the body of work that I had. I mean, aside from animation, I never get interviewed for commercial stuff because it's a different world. But I've done tens of thousands of voiceover commercials in my life, and so I have a, you know, I've got the ability to do those as well. So, because of the versatility that I could either teach an animation class for them, or I could go in and do an announcer, TV announcer, radio announcer class. That got me into it. And then after that, when I left that company, I simply started to do it on my own. Now I get people through my website. I get people who seek me out, and I do what I can.
That's pretty cool.
It is. It's fun. I mean, I've been really blessed. Most of my work now, though, isn't the teaching. I'll teach if I'm in town. I don't live in Toronto any longer. I'm a country boy now. I live out in way out in the boonies on 13 acres, and I love it. But
can't beat the boonies.
I do more voice directing than anything else. And you know what? I enjoy it as much as I enjoy performing, though I still do perform. And sometimes I even perform in my own shows if the producers pick me. But I'm really, really enjoying the voice directing. And it gives me a chance to kind of give back what I learned and teach people, hopefully, to be as successful as I was.
Yeah, and you started back in 1970.
That's when I started my voice work. I started my voice directing in 1992 with Sailor Moon.
So you actually, yeah, it does say you were part of Sailor Moon. What's it been like to be part of that one? I mean, that's a huge.
It was great. We had no idea what it was going to be at the time, of course, and it was a kind of a crazy recording session because it's all done post sync. It's all dubbed. It's ADR. Additional dialogue record, because that was all, of course, Japanese, and then it was recut for the American market, the North American market, and then we had to dub in the North American voices. And subsequent to that, now since we've just sort of gone through the 20th anniversary, and because they're redoing it now, I don't know if you're aware that Viz has the rights, and they're not only doing the one season that we never did,
right?
We did four, and they're now doing the fifth, and then they're going to go back and revoice all of the stuff that we did. But we've been touring now doing all the major cons for almost 2 years now, doing Anime Expo and Otakon, Boston, Anime Boston, Anime North twice, Vancouver, you know, LA, and gosh, everywhere. It's been quite wonderful.
That's pretty cool. You probably see a lot of, at the conventions, you probably see a lot of Sailor Moon costumes.
We do. A lot of really fabulous ones, too. Yeah, it's of all of the stuff that I've done, it's the most culty of all of them, and it's really, really great. And the people are all, I mean, I just have a world of admiration for all the people who do the cosplaying. I think they're just so dedicated. And I love the fact that all those people are no longer marginalized. You know, a few years ago, because it's happened really quickly, a few years ago, all those people would hide in their rooms and have little clubs and do this. And now there's 25,000 people dressed up, right? And they're just out there showing it off. And I think it's great. So all these people that were, well, you talked about nerds, but, you know, all those people that, when nerd isn't a bad word anymore, and all these people are mainstream now. And, boy, all you got to do is, like I say, go to Anime North or Anime Expo or Anime Boston. Oh, my God. And Baltimore, Otakon was just, you know, like all of these places. Wow. It's amazing. I love it. I think it's great. They're exuberant, they're happy, they're friendly, they're non-aggressive, they're just really, really, really good folks who are dedicated to what they love. More people should be more dedicated to what they love, be a better world.
Right, and yeah, something that I do talk about is Star Wars. And did you ever watch the original Star Wars in theater?
Yes, I did. I saw the original couple. I haven't followed it, I'll be honest with you. I have not followed it all the way through. It's not, it isn't really kind of my style of movie. It's gotten, I mean, I like the original ones because they were very innovative and novel and, you know, unusual. And now I almost find some of them a parody almost of the old ones. You know, everybody's trying so hard to be new and different and edgy that I just don't enjoy it as much. But the old ones, I love it. And you know what? That's maybe a factor of being an older guy.
So you're more for the original trilogy without the...
Yeah.
See,
I
just bought myself...
Yeah, I thought there was more acting and less... I like dialogue. I mean, that's why I do voice work, you know, and why I direct voice work as well, is because I'm a real dialogue fan.
Right.
And what we seem to gear towards now is the special effects and the visual effects, and though they're great, boy, it takes a lot to really, I think for a lot of people, it takes a lot to really impress us anymore.
Right.
Think, oh yeah, it's a new thing. Oh yeah. I mean, or you say, wow, that was great, and then you're like, what are you having for, what do you got in your popcorn? Right? We don't get really knocked out the way, you know what, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The older ones just were more dialogue and personality oriented, and I think a lot of that is missing now.
Right.
From a lot of movies, not just Star Wars.
So, but yeah, I myself like I'm a big Star Wars fan, in fact. So.
Yeah, well, you know what? I think if you have a passion, I mean, we all can't have a passion for everything. We wouldn't have time to do anything. We wouldn't have time to eat. Right, so you got to pick your passions, and I think they're all great.
It's right,
just, we all think differently. That's all.
And were you ever into Star Trek at all?
You know what? I've seen the original again, the Shatner, Nimoy, George Takei. You know, I've seen those thousands of times. I mean, that's my childhood. is watching, you know, seeing those, you know, those, the old ones, the real corny ones. But, boy, I'm glad I saw them because looking at City, see, now the Star Wars, Star Trek, rather, I think has progressed differently than Star Wars. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, nowadays, you know, now they're trying to outdo each other for effects, special effects. But, I mean, the I think some of the, you know, when Star Trek reemerged as the, you know, the newer one, I mean, 17 years ago still, I watched some of those, but I've never been like I can't sit down. I mean, I can't sit and watch TV, so that's probably a huge part of my problem. So watching the series, you know, when I was little, I was inside. When I was young, I was, you know, you watch TV. I
right.
Did. Now there's so many other options. Today it's great. I mean, really today, because we can stream anything we want, when we want, it's very, very different. You know, you wake up and have a sleepless night, you can watch what you want at 2 in the morning.
Yeah, just flip on Netflix.
Yeah, that's right.
And for mere $8 to $10 a month, you can stream anything.
You got the world.
That's what I do, is I stream a lot on Netflix, since I don't have cable. I just have internet, so.
Right.
And
yeah, well, I think cable's, you know, its time is near.
Right.
You know, once, I think, one more generation and you won't have it.
Right. And basically, you also were part of a couple of the, with the X-Men and the Avengers. What, were you ever a comic book fan or into superheroes at all?
Well, yes, I was. And I'm one of those guys that says, if I'd only kept those damn comic books, I could probably be retired in Monaco right now.
You'd be sitting
there
with
champagne.
Oh,
yeah, I had a lot of the old Superman comic books. God knows what happened to them. I mean, even, not even the superhero, but like Roy Rogers and the old cowboy comics and stuff. Geez, you know, who knew? What did we do with them, you know? Your mom said, you know, you haven't looked at those in years. Throw them out. Okay.
I understand how that is, because my parents, I had younger brothers and sisters, so that everything I had was passed on to them.
Right.
So,
well, I had two younger sisters, who were, you know, and girls, by and large, are not superheroes fans. I mean, there are some, but it's simply not their thing, generally speaking.
Right. Well, see, I had brothers, so.
Yeah, well, so it was perfect. They probably destroyed them, right, tore them apart.
Pretty much.
Yeah.
But then I got mad at when my one brother, he had an old R2-D2 action figure.
Uh-huh.
I got mad at him one day, and I broke the leg.
Oh, great. And now you'd probably pay what to get it?
I was, like, sitting here, like, to get a R2 unit on eBay is, like, you might be paying about $5 at minimum.
Yeah.
So.
Well, I'll tell you, a guy sent me a whole bunch of stuff to sign. He lives, he's on the other side of Toronto. He's like 4 hours away from me. So he mailed me some stuff, and I signed two of Lick's figurine in the original case, and two Duloc Scouts. And my daughter, who lives with us, said, "Have you priced those, Dad?" I said, "No, I haven't." She said, "Let me check this." She went on eBay. $400.
Just without them signed, huh?
Without the sign, without the signature, yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, that's, that's eBay. I mean, they may not go for that, but that was, I don't know if that was the asking or if that was the current bid, but it said $399.
It might have been the current bid, or.
Yeah.
Because asking price sometimes is, even though the asking price sometimes, they'll just put a straight buy it now. For such a price.
Yeah. So there you go for stuff like that. And they were in pristine shape, too. I mean, as I say, still in original packaging and the plastic.
See, I myself also am an autograph collector. And
are you?
I have, I got a pretty good-sized Star Wars autograph collection right now started. So.
Well, you send me, I'll definitely, if you want some stuff is, you'll mail it to me.
I sure can do
that. All I ever ask for is return postage, you know?
Oh yeah, I'll include. This is what I learned over the years for autograph collecting is if you send it in the mail, send an envelope with return postage.
Yep.
I mean, or if I send it like to the UK, or I don't know if you guys are.
Our postage is different than yours as well. Yeah.
Right. So I usually just send a little bit of cash to.
Yeah, that's all. But there you go. And everybody listening to this, not for you.
Oh, not a lot of people are autograph collectors that I have listened to my podcast, so.
Okay.
But I basically got Carrie Fisher through the mail.
Really?
Yeah,
wow.
She actually signed a photo for me. I actually had somebody on this one website that I kind of used to make sure it's authentic, or I even used eBay for it, and it's real. So
wow.
I'm like, dang.
That's nice.
Luck of the draw.
Yeah, man. Well, you know, I think if you're polite enough and, you know what, I mean, that's what you do. Like I say, when I go to a con, somebody wants my autograph, I charge for it. But you know what? Can't charge for everything, and sometimes you get people to come up to you and they say, oh man, I'd really like it, you know, as a sign, whatever, but I have no money. It's like, oh, here. You know, not everybody's got it. If I know somebody's got a few beans in their pocket, and that's different. But you can't, I hate to refuse anybody. I honestly do. Maybe I'm a jerk that way, because I know I look at some people who say, no, you got to, you know, you draw the line.
Yeah, I understand.
You gotta get money, but I can't do that. It's my, you know, it's a bloody signature. It's not like I'm, you know, giving away, the keys to my car.
Right. I mean, it's something that you gotta make a living.
Yeah, I know, but I just can't say no to a lot of people. That's all. I can't say no to anybody.
Right.
And I don't think you have to. I mean, people who pay. If somebody, you know, looks, you know, says to you, you know, quietly, I haven't got any money, I'd really like it, can you give it to me for less? Usually I just say, you know, what do you got? I got a couple of bucks. That's great. Okay. Got enough money to get home? Well, I don't know. Keep your money. Make sure you got enough for the bus.
Right.
And here you go. Thank you. Glad you were a fan. Take this home. Don't tell anybody you got it for free.
Yeah. And that's something that's some of those signers that's do it through the mail. I've had the pleasure of, even Drew Karpyshyn was so nice to me. He even wrote a note back and said he hoped that I enjoyed his book Revan that I'm still
right.
currently reading since I sent that letter, and he sent it back.
Nice.
So, but yeah, I mean, it's been a lot of fun. I mean, collecting autographs, and I frame them and put them on the Star Wars ones especially.
Yeah,
framed and put on my wall.
Really nice.
So,
that's really nice.
But
it's a good passion to have. It's harmless.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
So, basically, and how you've been a director for a while, so is it any easier being a director over just an actor, or is it?
It's tougher. It's a lot more work. Because when you're an actor, I mean, if I have a role in a show, sure, I should still read the whole script, because,
right.
I mean, that's old school, but I believe, you know, you got to read the script in order to read your lines properly, because there's context and references and everything else that you should know, but you don't have to study everybody else's lines. You should go over them and know the story and the flow of it. The only lines you have to kind of study are your own, and even though you're going to be reading them, you don't have to know them off by heart, but still, you've got to work on your own and make sure that they're delivered properly, because when you go in and read, you read on your own. You don't read with other people. Most animation is recorded one at a time. When I voice direct, though, I have to know every single line. And in a 22-minute show, which is basically your half-hour show,
right,
where it's their commercials, in a 22-minute show, there are probably 240 lines. I've got to know how every single one of those is delivered.
Right. So.
And that's the tough part. I don't have, you know, when I perform, well, I got to know maybe 20 lines or 30 lines or 50 lines even.
Right.
But I don't have to know how every single line in that show is delivered. When I'm a voice director, I've got to look through and add things. I think, you know what, the character should laugh here, but there's no line assigned. So I'm going to write that in, you know, so-and-so laughs. And then I've got to make sure that when that performer comes in, I'm going to say, okay, at this point I want you to give me a little laugh because so-and-so makes a face at you. And it doesn't say you react, but I think you would react. So give me a little laugh in there. So right. I have to do all those additions. I have to. But it's great. I truly enjoy it. You know, as a matter of fact, when I get off the phone with you, I'm working on a series now that I'm going to be sitting down and doing some highlighting and line counting and get ready for that too. So.
Well, that's pretty cool.
Yeah.
And then you also were part of, I'm going back to kind of the voice acting, you actually were part of the Redwall characters.
Yes, I did. Redwall was 3 seasons. And again, you're picking another Nelvana show. You've hit every Nelvana show so far. And, yeah, I was different characters in each one. Episode, in the first season, I was... what the heck was my character? Abbott Mordalfus. And... remember who I was? Was it Cheese Thief in season 2? And then season 3, I had a really, really major role. The role of Clog, who had a really, really weird, weird voice. God knows we worked really hard to develop it. I remember working for about an hour trying to get the voice right. And then every time I went back into the studio, I couldn't get it again. They'd have to play me my reference. And then I would get the voice again. That was a lot of fun. That was a tough job, but a great one.
Yeah, and it's still played on like PBS and stuff like that.
Yeah, I know. It's really something.
I mean, I was watching it. I was like, "Dang, that's not too bad of a show."
No, it's not. I don't get a lot of like. It's interesting. I kind of gauge the audience for it in terms of how many requests I get to sign things. And I get very, very few for Redwall. They're very dedicated, the fan group, but it's not a huge fan base.
Right. You probably don't get a lot of people talking about it either.
No, I do not. But when I do, they're very knowledgeable, and there's a ton of material in Redwall, and a lot of books, and it's a lot of material. They only scratched the surface with 3 seasons.
Right.
One more.
And then, did you ever do any audiobooks or anything like that?
No, I have not done audiobooks. One of the major reasons is that a lot of them are done non-union, we didn't do a lot in Toronto. It's not a center for audiobooks. As well, Toronto is a huge animation center, biggest in North America, and it's huge, and it would be, I guess, second or third largest commercial market in North America, behind New York and L.A.
Right. So you get to have all the fun of the animation stuff.
Well, I do. I mean, there are right now. Toronto's probably got 30. Series in production.
Right.
Unbelievable number. Unbelievable. And we get a lot of American producers who come up here too. I just finished voice directing a series for Disney, but it wasn't done in L.A. It was done in Toronto.
Right. So, and what series was that?
It's called Ella the Elephant.
Oh, Ella the Elephant? I think I've heard something like about that. It's like a Disney kids TV show.
Yeah. Very sweet. It's only one season, but I think we did 26 of them. They had just different issues with it, apparently. It was Disney and Fremantle. And a lovely series, but unfortunately it only lasted a season. Most animated series now are only one or two seasons. If you go to 3 seasons or 4, you've really got a winner.
Yeah, so you haven't actually had a chance to sit down and, you know, there's a new Rebels TV show?
No, I've not seen
it. It's a new Star Wars. You haven't had a chance to see that?
Not yet, no.
It's actually going back kind of to the old Ralph McQuarrie type design.
Mm-hmm. Interesting. There's a lot of big trend back to 2D now, too, which is really something.
Right. The
weird, you know, what's old is new kind of thing.
Right. So, but yeah, there's a lot of different good things coming out with that's having the old animation style.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, and a lot of it is, I mean, a lot of it is going back to a lot of hand drawing now, too, again. As opposed to everything being CG. There's just a different feel to it. And so, you know, it's great. The animation schools are everywhere now, and I think a lot of people are into it. With the advent of more and more and more video games, too, and boy, I think it's a wonderful, wonderful time to be an animator or being in any phase of the animation business.
Right, and you've got a son of your own.
I have a son? Did you say?
Yep.
Yeah, I have two sons.
You have two
How
sons?
How did you know? Pardon?
Some of it is listed on IMDb.
Oh my goodness. Yeah, my son. Well, my older boy did some acting for quite a while when he was little, and did well enough that that he saved that money and had his retirement savings plan put away by the union, and 5 years ago bought himself a condominium. So
that's pretty cool.
He did really, really well. My daughter is in the business as well. My daughter's going to be 21 in a couple of days, and she has done fairly well in the business. Been the lead in a bunch of series, and took a break for university, but she's back at it now. And yeah, it's nice. I mean, I guess it's in the genes. What can I say?
Hey, always nice to pass on the.
Well, as long as I can pass on the good stuff. There's a lot of bad stuff, like any business, you know.
Right. See, I got a son. He actually ended up going through heart surgery when he was just, like, within 6 months of when he was born.
Oh, my. Is he okay?
He's doing very well now, and his name is Lucas.
Okay. I wonder where that came from.
His mom allowed me to... I don't talk... Actually say her name, because she don't like me talking about her very much, but she let me talk... take and name him Lucas.
Well, good.
So.
Real good.
Yes, he's actually doing very well. And he's
How old is he?
He's 3 now.
Beautiful, beautiful.
His favorite character is, besides Thomas the Tank Engine, is Herbie the Love Bug.
So, funny.
Yeah, he's...
And, I gotta tell you, you know where Thomas the Tank Engine was recorded, don't you?
Toronto.
Of course.
Well, that's very good to know.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah, I've got, I still work with a lot of the people that did that.
Right.
That series.
So, well, I'd say we could wrap up the recording here.
Sure.
So, and thanks for coming on to talk to me on the recording here.
Hey, man, it was really, really a pleasure. Thanks for letting me ramble.
Oh, not a problem.
It's always fun to reminisce and talk about the business. It's a great one.
And do you have any upcoming events or anything you'd like to promote?
Well, thank you for that. I'm not the only thing I'm promoting right now is two months in Mexico to get away from the cold. I've got a couple of offers for a couple of cons. But nothing that I can put down and say, yeah, because I haven't signed the contract yet. But, hey, listen, you know, anybody listening who wants to invite me to a con, I'm pretty open. I love going to them, and I love meeting all the folks that watch the stuff or have heard of the stuff I've done. So I've yet to go to a Star Wars, Star Wars con. I'm waiting for one of those, for somebody to say, hey, Stalker, you know, bring your pictures of everything you did in Droids and Ewoks.
So you have not even been invited to Celebration Anaheim this next year?
No.
What the heck? We're going to have to talk to Lucasfilms about that.
Really?
Yeah.
You go ahead and do that, man. I would be there in a heartbeat.
Yeah, we'll have to take and see what we can do. I'll have to have some of my listeners start hounding Lucasfilm.
I would love it. I would love it very, very, very much, Ben. Thank you.
And, yeah, it's pretty good that you actually are there for your fans. And
well, you know what? Like I said earlier, and I mean it, I know it sounds corny, but I really, really mean it. You know, we're kind of all in it together. My part is performing, and some people listen and watch, and it's all the same.
Right.
We do it because we love it. You watch because you love it. I do it because I love it. And because I'm really nothing without you guys, and you don't have, you know, your enjoyment without me. So it's a kind of a team effort, isn't it?
Right. It pretty much is.